without many of the things we value and enjoy here at Mamo. We are grateful to see opportunities for in-person worship as well as youth group resume. Unfortunately, it remains a logistical challenge to incorporate other important and valued activities like Sunday school while adhering to Alberta government worship guidelines. To this end, the CE is pleased to be able to offer a kids club for children in grade 1 through 6 in lieu of Sunday school for the short term. This will be bi-weekly after school program from 4 to 5:30 p.m. starting March 2nd for Mamo families with students in grade 1 through 6. There will be Bible lessons, music, and crafts in a setting that can be meet the current guidelines. We look forward to seeing your children there. If you have any questions, feel free to contact the CE board, Patty Peterson, Sarah Kinsey, myself, or Marcia Schultz. Thank you.
Thank you, Deb. We continue to try to make efforts to normalize life. Good morning. Grace, mercy, and peace to you all, to us all, from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. May he be with you all this morning. Welcome to worship at Mamo Mission Covenant Church this morning. A couple of things. This week there's going to be a new booking system. So on Tuesday morning you'll see an email come through so you can book a seat in the building. Hopefully this will add some clarity for you who are trying to get a seat. And just remember, if you're in the musicians, if you're on audio video, all those pieces, there's a place for you to book a seat as well. So get your seat. So that'll come out Tuesday morning. Just watch for that. Tuesday morning, the new system, by email, that'll come out. We continue to stream the services, and so we continue to be open to volunteers. If anybody's around or has some extra time to help out, that would be a real asset, a real gift to us. This morning, if you are, we've been trying this the past couple of weeks, and it seems to work a little bit. If you have a prayer request you want to get into us and you're not here but you're watching from home, you can text my phone, 780-360-2002, 780-360-2002. You can do that this morning as well. All right. Hey, it's good to see you. It's good to see you all. Let's pray together. Spirit of the living God, we invite your presence in ways that we can't even give language to. We want you to know our hearts, and we want you to know our desires, and we want to spend some time with you now, Lord. So would you come and be present? Fill this place with your ministering angels that they might add to the music and the worship and the praise and add to your glory, Father, that you might be present here with us for this next time. And for anybody who's engaging at home in worship, that your spirit would fill their rooms and their watching areas. You would be present there to them and with them, Father. Let your glory just fall upon them and among them, we pray now. In Jesus' name, amen. Jan is going to lead us in some worship this morning.
Good morning. If you'd like to stand, feel free to stand. Even if you're at home, stand up.
Great is your faithfulness, O God. You wrestle with the sinner's heart. You lead us by still waters into mercy, and nothing can keep us apart. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, oh God. For your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. Great is your love and justice, God of Jacob. You use the weak to lead the strong. after all. You lead us in the song of your salvation, and all your people sing along. So remember your people, remember your children, remember your promise, oh God. Your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me. Your grace is enough, your grace is enough, your grace is enough for me.
To 22. For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, to bring you to God. He was put to death in the body, but made alive in the spirit. After being made alive, he went and made proclamation to the imprisoned spirits, to those who were disobedient long ago when God waited patiently in the days of Noah while the ark was being built. In it, only a few people, eight in all, were saved through water. And this water symbolizes baptism that now saves you also. Not the removal of dirt from the body, but the pledge of a clear conscience toward God. It saves you by the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at God's right hand, with angels, authorities, and powers in submission to him.
Thank you, Marianne. And Jan and worship team. Hey, this is the part of our worship time when we share our prayer requests and we pray together with one another and just to kind of support each other and hold each other up. So if you have some prayer requests you brought or praise items, things you're just thanking God for today, this is the place and this is the time to share them. I'll hold my phone close if anybody wants to text one in. That's fine. You can do that. But start in the room here today. We'll start here. Anybody have anything for today they'd like to ask for prayer for or praise? It's a bit tricky. Some of you wear masks, and I can't see completely who's back there, but I'll just point if you have. Hi, Heather. Go for it. Yeah. Thanks. We can be praying for you tomorrow. So Heather is saying that some of her health issues that she's been having with her heart is the result of the meds she's been taking. And so they're going to address the meds, which is always a scary thing, always. And so be praying for Heather tomorrow and this week, okay, as you think of her. That'd be great. Let's do that. Patty. Mm-hmm. Find the new rhythms. Yeah. Amen. So just Jan Carlson? Jane, sorry. Yeah. Jane Carlson is still in the hospital, and they're still sorting that out, her fall she had a week ago. Let's keep praying for her. And for little Oscar, who is new to this world, and so he was invited back for a second performance in the hospital. No, he just had to go to the hospital a little bit this week to sort some things out. And so I guess that's sorted, and it's all good, and he's on his way home today, right? So, but keep praying for him, okay? And pray for his mom and dad. It's hard enough to find, you know, I mean, many of you know, it's hard enough to find the new rhythms when you're a new parent, and it can be terrifying and overwhelming. Let's pray for mom and dad, for grandma and grandpa, and for little Oscar, too. It's pretty cool. Anyone else? Marianne. Yeah. We're continuing to pray for Jarrett, for his health and his heart, and for his well-being and for his future. Keep praying for him and for them, for him and his wife. Some of you will remember a couple weeks ago, we were praying for Gaylene, who was needing a place to live because hers was suddenly she just lost the place to live because of the health of the caregivers, and she's just saying, praising God for a safe place to live now. So she's landed well, and that's an answer to prayer, so. Thank you for that. Thanks for praying for Gaylene. Anyone else? Ruth. Okay. Excellent. Our friend Audrey, who lives by herself on her own, and due to health issues, she's not always able to come. And so we keep praying for Audrey. It has been just about a year since she's been here, and so keep praying for her. Would you send our love to Audrey when you talk with her next as well, please? Let's keep praying for them. Those of our elderly who can't come out and don't come out at all and have been in their places for a long time, let's just keep praying for them. Anyone else? All right. Well, Heather. Okay.
So my niece, Yana, towards the end, she's having, she has a single vegetable, so she made her own because of her stuff. But now, for her, rhythm isn't always helping, I guess I could say. So on Tuesday, she's having a tiny little thing service next to the restroom that's a loop recorder, which
Yana, who's having a little heart procedure this week, that might go well. We're praying for her. Pray as you remember and think of her, okay? Last call? All right. Hey, let's pray together. Would you join your hearts in prayer, even as I pray out loud? Pray in your spirit. Let's pray together. Father, though we are here in this room, or we are kind of through the community, your spirit is with us. And we recognize that. That unites us all. Father, just ties us together in Jesus Christ. And we thank you for that gift of presence that we have with each other and with you. So this morning we lift up our prayer items. As we've mentioned here, the prayer items we might not even be able to have words for to give you, Father, but we pray that your Spirit would hear our prayers, our requests, the burdens of our hearts, Lord. We pray for our families and our community. We pray for our marriages and for our mental health, Lord. We pray for our kids as they struggle with school and the context of life in these days. We pray for our elderly, our moms and dads and our grandmas and grandpas, Lord. Have mercy on us all as we go through this season of life. It can be a wonderful season as you can use these things for your glory and our good. But sometimes we don't want to learn. Sometimes it's hard for us to learn these things. Be patient with us, Father. Be patient, have mercy upon us. Be close to us, support us, and sustain us all day and all through the night, that your glory might be with us to encourage us and give us hope and a future, Lord. And we do give you all the praise and the glory for the answered prayers, for a system, a streaming system that works, Father, properly, for these technology pieces that can go together to help us continue to meet to be the church, Father, together. We thank you for them, and we ask your blessing. We ask for volunteers who can help us with these things and just walk with us through this season and just care for these details of life that need attention, Father. We thank you for your presence, your spirit to be with us. We thank you that you're watching out for us, you're providing for us. Would you continue to be our God in very personal ways and in very profound ways. We ask your blessing upon this world, that you would deliver the world of this heaviness and this sickness, that you would deliver us, Father, from this disease, this virus, Lord. Have mercy, especially on the parts of the world that where there's less money and there's less resources and it's much darker, Lord. We pray for our brothers and sisters living in those areas, that you would be present to them and with them, Lord. Oh, Father, we give you thanks now for your gifts to all of us and how you watch out for us. We pray now in Jesus' name, all these things. Amen. Let's sing another song.
Thy hand hath provided.
Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Let's pray. Jesus, now be present to teach us. Be our teacher this morning, Father. Show us the little things that you have for us, Father, from your word. Be our guide, our teacher, our discipler. Be present now in these next few moments, I pray. Amen. Amen. So, my friends, I was going to mention this earlier, but I had announcements on my mind, and I was trying to get us into the service. It's the first Sunday in Lent today. I'm sorry. It is the first Sunday in Lent. It's not cheer-worthy, but just so you know, that's where I'm going for the next few minutes as we talk a little bit about Lent and what it means for us and to us. Lent is our 40-day pilgrimage to the cross and to Easter proper. And 40 days, when you start counting them, it gets a little fuzzy. Some churches count these days, not those days, and some have 36, not four. It's a bit of a gong show that way. But it is a season of preparation for Easter that's coming. And it's going to come a little bit earlier this year because we're in February and we're into Lent now, and so it's coming. Now, historically, Lent is a season, it's a time for the examination of our choices, our hearts. It's an examination of the way we manage and live our lives. That's kind of what the purpose of Lent is, to prepare in preparation. And it is based on Christ's 40 days in the wilderness. And it leads right up into Easter, Good Friday, Holy Saturday, and then Easter Sunday itself. Examining ourselves, examining our hearts is a good thing to do once in a while. It's a great thing to do, practice once a year, and to practice maybe once a month. Maybe even it's good to think about once each day. How has my day gone with God? To do a bit of self-examination there. Just to help us create a sense of sensitivity to the directions we are going in life in relationship to God, who is our Father, our Heavenly Father, and our overarching God. Henry Nouwen, and you'll have seen this hopefully in the email that you received on Friday, but Henry Nouwen said this: Lent is a time of returning to God. It is a time to confess how we keep looking for joy and peace and satisfaction in the many people and things surrounding us without really finding what we desire. Only God can give us what we want. So we must be reconciled with God. The season of Lent helps us in a special way to cry out for God's mercy. That was by Henry Nouwen. That's a pretty profound little insight and a concept. I want you to consider looking at Lent as a very personal, a very human, a very insightful journey to the cross, to Jesus Christ, and to his resurrection. I want you to consider this Lent as a part of that for yourselves. So how do we set ourselves up for success with Lent, with the season of Lent? Well, Paul gives us some indication in his letters to the church at Corinth. I'm just going to stop there land there for the next few moments. You see, there was false teachers that were coming into the church at Corinth, okay? They had pushed themselves into the Corinthian church, and they were turning the hearts of the people against Paul, who was away from town in this time, and would write them letters of instruction. And these false teachers would come in and say, yeah, Paul, he's a little flaky about this and that. You don't have to really listen to him. He says this and he does this. Isn't he a little weird? And they were just poking. They were just poking these false teachers. And that was what was going on in Corinth. So Paul had to defend his apostolic ministry and his authority against the claims of people who were criticizing him severely. They were letting him have it with the local people. In the second letter to the church at Corinth, he warns the church against them, and he exposes the false apostles and false teachers that they are. And now he wants to bring the faithful believers back to the true things of God. So he instructs them this. He instructs them to examine themselves. Examine yourselves. And we find that in 2 Corinthians 13, verses 5 to 6. If you want to go there, well, you can go there. 2 Corinthians 13, just two verses, verse 5 and 6 this morning. Paul writes to the church at Corinth, and he writes to us as well. Examine yourselves to see if your faith is genuine. Test yourselves. Surely you know that Jesus Christ is among you. If not, you have failed the test of genuine faith. As you test yourselves, I hope you will recognize that we have not failed the test of apostolic authority. Just stop there. Just stop there. Paul is asking the regular people, the regular people in Corinth, to take a deep look inside themselves. Just stop, people, where you're at. Just stop. Do some self-examination to see if they are in the faith, to see if they are part of the church, part of the kingdom of God. You see, some in Corinth were asking for proof that Paul could provide, that Christ speaks through him. Really, Paul, God speaks through you? We kind of would like some more proof or some evidence, if you will. But Paul smartly turns the question around on them. And instead of answering those questions and that question, he says to them to conduct a spiritual audit of themselves. Look at yourselves first, people. Look inside and see what's going on in there. To see how they check out as Christians, he says, test yourselves. Prove yourselves that Christ is among you. Christ is there inside of you, with you. Prove, look inside and see that Christ Jesus is there. He's not telling them, and this is interesting, he's not telling them that he's right and the false prophets are wrong. He's not getting into that, you know, back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. He's not going down that road at this point anyway. He's pointing them to Jesus, and he's asking them to look to Jesus in their lives for some clarity here. You see, he's a wise teacher. He's doing the right thing here. When his disciples are questioning his leadership, he's not forcing that argument. He's not saying, I'm bigger than you, or I'm smarter than you, or I'm more spiritual than you. No, he's saying, go ask God. You go out, talk to God. This is your issue between you and God about my leadership here. Go talk to God and look inside and start there. Go talk to God about this. And he's not forcing his leadership on them. He's not speaking out of a place of insecurity. Man, sometimes we do that. No, fall in line. Do what I tell you to do. Do what you're supposed to do, for Pete's sake. And we do that out of a sense of insecurity. They're challenging my leadership. Who do they think they are? When in fact, it's God's church. It's not ours. All we have to do is point them to God and say, okay, you go look at your heart. You go look at yourself. Go see if Jesus is among you. Go talk to God. It's Christ's church, not his, not mine, not ours. And as they examine themselves, and as they look for Christ in and among themselves, Paul's belief is that they will see the things the same way as he does, as they look to Jesus, right? He's just saying, go look to Jesus. Talk to Jesus about this. Verse 6, as you test yourselves, I hope you will recognize that we have not failed the test of apostolic authority. We are your apostle. We've been given this responsibility to you. His hope is that they will turn back to Jesus to evaluate and to examine their lives. They will be drawn back to Christ. And they will respond to Paul as an apostle again. And that they will reject the false teachers. This is always a good strategy for church leaders, my friends. For church leaders, this is a wonderful strategy laid out here. I will never forget, early in my work, in my career, the day it dawned on me that I was not responsible to be the leader of the church. I didn't have to carry all that stuff. I didn't have to fight for certain doctrines or certain belief systems. All I had to do was point people to Jesus and say, okay, is Jesus among you? Go and sort it out with you and him. I'll be here to support you and teach you and be your guide and whatever you need. But you need to work this out with Jesus, because he's got some things he wants to show you and to show us. And that's all we can do as leaders. And many times when people create walls against us, all we can do is say, go look at God. Go look at what Jesus is saying. You see, in this passage, Paul comments that self-examination meant a self-examination. You look at your own life. You don't look at others' lives in comparison. He wasn't saying, compare yourselves to me, to Paul himself. He wasn't saying, compare your faith to my faith. Let's see how you stack up and how you add up. Because they had been led astray by these false teachers, and they didn't trust Paul now. He wasn't saying, compare yourself to me. He wasn't saying, compare yourself to one another, to each other, the spiritual among you. He wasn't saying that at all. That's not helpful in any way. And anyway, that just leads you in other sin-filled ways and avenues. Self-examination is just that, an examination of the self, of ourselves. This is the time to look at oneself, to turn, well, this is a creepy picture, but to turn one's eyes inward. Okay, let's pretend we didn't say that. To look at yourself, that's a better way of saying turning your eyes inward. To look at yourself, examine yourself. It's just that. In the season of Lent, it's not helpful to compare ourselves to the others around us. In any way or in any capacity, is that ever helpful? On the day we stand before the Lord for Judgment Day, and he will say, why should we invite you into heaven? Well, I was better than so-and-so. Did you see what they did? And Jesus, God will say, that's immaterial. We don't judge you by the next person. We have to judge ourselves. And as they examine themselves and as they look for Christ in and among themselves, Paul's belief is that they will see things the same way that he did as they look to Jesus, as they look to Christ. What's been going on inside of me? Especially this year. It's been a tough year for so many reasons. Where am I going? What's going on in here? With my family, with my friends, with my own understanding of myself, maybe, with my own understanding of God. I might be angry, I might be fed up or impatient. What's been going on inside of us? And who have we been following? Have we been following maybe other teachers? Maybe they might be or they might not be false teachers. Have we been following them, or maybe even more possible, have we been following ourselves and our own way, our own agenda? Faith in this passage, as Paul writes it, faith does not refer to simply to trust in Jesus Christ, which is its primary meaning in Paul's usage. But faith used here is the whole Christian way of and truth of life. He's saying, look at your whole way of understanding. Look at how you understand your relationship with God. How are you connecting with God? It's not primarily a matter of examining their doctrines. It's not just that, but of examining their behavior in Christ as well. They're invited to bring their conduct and their thinking into conformity with their belief in Jesus Christ. And there is wisdom in that for all of us. Well, duh, of course. Of course we would want that. We're invited to bring how we behave and what we believe in conformity with Jesus Christ. When our beliefs are off, okay? When our beliefs are off, and they're not focused on God, but they're focused on the other, or they're focused on myself, we start to go off on a different trajectory, just like these Corinthians were starting to do because of the false teachers. It was starting small, but it was growing in momentum. They were going off on in a direction that wasn't godly, wasn't God's leading. It's our behavior, friends. It's our behavior that will tip us off that something isn't right. It's what we find ourselves doing and saying that should show us, no, something's wrong here. Something isn't right. Something's going on inside of us. Our actions are the fruit of what's inside our hearts. Luke 6:45 says it this way, a good man brings good things out of the good stored up in his heart, and an evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in his heart. For the mouth speaks what the heart is full of. That sentence, that is one of those guiding principle sentences that we should commit to memory. The mouth speaks what the heart is full of. Watch, try, judge, see. See if people don't speak what their hearts are full of. You can tell that. Listen to yourself speak. That's a scary thought when you talk to your kids. Hey, I've been there. I remember. I've done that. But we listen to ourselves talk and how we carry ourselves and how we talk about others. And we watch how we're behaving and how we're living our lives. When someone says or does something from a dark or an angry place, it's an indication that something is wrong, or at least that something isn't right in our hearts. There's something broken in our hearts. It's our actions, it's our behavior that gives us away. And when, friends, when we stop seeing the evil in it, if we can't even see our behavior and the words coming out of our mouths as bad or dark or evil, we're already down a whole different road. When we stop seeing the evil in it, we become blind to our own behavior. That's a scary line that we sometimes will cross. But it is our behavior that gives us away. It can be a red flag for us if we want to see it. So in another place, in another letter, actually, Paul writes to these same people in another place, all of our sins, all are covered. All of them are covered. And Scripture invites us to confess our sin to God, which requires a certain amount of self-examination. 1 John 8. If we claim to be without, talk about deceiving yourself. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves. And the truth isn't in us. But if we confess our sin, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Stopping to examine ourselves with the help of the Holy Spirit can be the gift of freedom to us, friends. Life, freedom, joy, laughter again. It can be the way forward, the way to being free, the way to being forgiven, to know the joy in life again, and to be in a right relationship with God again. He brings us back to himself again. But it all starts when we stop and look in the mirror. It all starts right there if we're willing to go through a Lent of self-examination. I'm going to close with this. The Chicago Tribune reported in September 6th, 2000, Andreas Tomas had been drafted into the army, but the authorities mistook his native Hungarian language for the gibberish of a lunatic, and they had him committed to a psychiatric hospital in Russia. And then they forgot about him for 53 years. A few years ago, so this would be the late 1990s, a few years ago, the doctor began to realize what had happened and helped Tomas recover the memories of who he was and where he came from. He recently returned home to Budapest as the last prisoner of World War II. This old man hadn't seen his own face in 5 decades. He hadn't seen himself in 5 decades, 50 years. So for hours, the old man studied his face in a mirror, the deep-set eyes, the gray stubble on the chin, the furrows of the brow. It was his face. But what a startling revelation to see it after 53 years. Imagine looking at your own face in a mirror and not recognizing who you saw. Imagine that. Imagine the horrific moment that would be for us. But friends, that's what happens to us when we don't take time to look in the mirror. When for a long time, maybe even 50 years, we don't look at ourselves and who we are becoming. We take no time for reflection, for observing, for examination. Lent is now here, friends. It's time to look in the mirror. We can do that. Let's take time for our own 40-day pilgrimage to the cross. Let's take time for that to happen. Let's take time for the examination of our choices and our hearts and the way we manage and live our lives, the way we look in the mirror, and all shall be well. Let's pray. Jesus, it is such a wonderful gift that your word is not heavy and oppressive to the point of death. You've given us a way forward, a road, a path to you, a pathway to the cross where you died and shed your blood for us. There is enough blood for our sins if we but own them and look in the mirror and see who we have become. Oh God, would you give each of us courage to look in the mirror? to do a season of self-evaluation, to look inside at who we're becoming. And maybe something is in there that needs your attention, Lord. Would you point that out to us by your Holy Spirit? Go into that season with us, Lord. Don't let us go alone, but go with us into that place by your Holy Spirit. Be present to us. Show us ourselves. Show us our hearts and our behavior and our actions. And as we bring it under the blood of Jesus for washing and forgiveness, set us free. Set us free, Jesus, this Lenten season. That was the reason you came and you died on the cross, so that we might know true freedom. We thank you this day for the freedom that's ours in Jesus Christ. It's not a heavy thing. It's a joyful, wonderful thing. And we give you thanks this morning. Amen. Jan, you have a closing song?
Please feel free to sing the first line or the second.
May the Lord bless you. Keep you and make his face to shine upon, and when we part ways, may you know his grace, round everlasting. God be the glory forever and ever. To God be the praise of all men. To God be the glory forever and ever. To God be the glory, amen. To God be may the Lord bless you, and may he keep you, and make his face to shine upon, and when we part ways, may you know his grace, may hope everlasting keep you strong. God be the glory forever and ever. To God be the praise of all men. To God be the glory forever and ever. To God be the glory, amen.
Well, my friends, we go into this week, and I want you to know that as your pastor, I'm praying for you. I'm praying for you this Lenten season. I pray for you in your journey to the cross. I pray for your hearts, your relationships. I pray for your choices and your decisions just to lead you more and more in that direction towards Jesus. And friends, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace, both now and in the days that are to follow. Amen. Go in peace.